it's movie time, and we're gonna start things off with the worst one. It was as bad as I heard, and it was as bad as I thought it would be. Holy shit. The script for this film is fucking cringe incarnate. It, like, one or two jokes kind of landed. It got a chuckle out of me. But, like, the majority of this film is just painfully super unfunny. All the characters are fucking blithering retards. Fucking Taika Waititi's in this, and he's hamming it up. He can't even save it. It's just so obnoxious. And the technical aspects, the filmmaking, it's all... The special effects, while sometimes they can look kind of nice, they can be super shoddy at times. The soundtrack of this film was fucking garbage. It was all just fucking bland, inoffensive pop music. And the score was just super generic. And it got so annoying. Fucking Genius of Love, that Tom Tom Club song. It's a bop, sure. But they do that fucking annoying thing where they turn it into this big, epic, orchestral fucking piece. And it's, oh, fuck. Kill me now. This was so bad. Next.
80.
Wow. The new Matrix was bad. I'm so shocked. Fuck me. The first act of this film was fucking horrid. It was so up its own ass. It just gave me such a fucking headache. Like, yeah, good job, fucking Lana and Lily. You made the Matrix. Good for you. Stop reminding us you only made, like, one good movie. But the second and third acts were tolerable. They were bad, but they at least were watchable. I mean, the actors tried. Keanu was charming, you know. Whatever. Buddy from fucking Mindhunter was Agent Smith. He was kind of fun. The filmmaking, like the visual style, it had glimpses here and there of what made the Matrix super cool, but it was in general just so subpar. It just, fuck this film. Giant pile of trash. Skip it. Next.
79.
Oh man. So, this is how bad M. Night has gotten. Fuck. Man, there were some neat ideas in terms of cinematography. There's some really cool shots in this film. And the score for this film was fine, I guess. But the script, though, was just all over the fucking place. Like, fucking the dialogue was super fucking weird. But then again, that's all his movies. But there were moments in this film that were supposed to be super disturbing, but they were downright fucking comical. Like, it just, and the ending was just dumb as fuck. And undercut what could have been an existential nightmare of a film. Like, oh wow, it was fucking Big Pharma at it again. Like, dude, just focus on the fact that these people are rapidly aging and going through some fucked up shit. Like, that's all you need to do. Fuck M. Night. Fuck this. Next.
78.
There's a full review of this on the channel, but, you know, Mortal Kombat, gore is fun, special effects were kind of fine, I guess. The writing was just dumb, though. Like, dumb as fuck. And they messed up quite a few characters in terms of presentation and backstory. In general, it just overcomplicated a stupid fucking mythology like Mortal Kombat. Like, it's not... How do you fuck this up? Fuck this. Bad film. Skip it. Next.
77.
Alright, so I kind of forgot to talk about this film when I initially recorded the video. But, Demonic, new Neil Blomkamp film. Fucking yikes. Well, what the fuck happened, Neil? God damn, you were once very promising. The filmmaking in this film, it was pretty, it was mid. Mid at best. Fucking, it felt cheap all over. And there were these video game sequences in the film. They were fucking hilarious. They fucking looked like shit. So funny. And the script, it was dumb, but it could have been like really fun, sort of dumb. Like, there were some really fun ideas. There was a fucking like squad of like special forces priests. I called them the fucking God Squad, the fucking Holy Rollers. Fucking, that could have been fun. Make a movie about them. But they were barely in it, and the script was just fucking generic, boring, fucking spoopy nonsense. Man, Neil was primed for so many good things, and now he's just reduced to this. Fuck this garbage. Miss this shit. Next.
76.
Check out a TikTok I made. Yeah, I'm on TikTok. I don't use it much anymore. It's, but, you know, it's there. I made a quick review of it. But, Spiral, Book of Saw, this film was bad, but surprisingly, it wasn't irredeemable. The plot moved along at a predictable, like, cop drama tier pace, and it was serviceably nonsensical. You know, it clipped along things, you know, I could understand what they were going for, but it was just generally fucking nonsense. The traps and the gore were, like, fine, but a ton of the other Saw films were just so much better in that regard. Fucking Chris Rock, though, horrible actor. Man, he just cannot do serious acting for shit. The best part of this film was, like, the beginning in terms of his acting, and he was just doing a fucking comedy bit. Like, he needs to really just stay in his fucking lane. Oh my god. Bad film. Next.
75.
Fucking Fear Street Part 3. This is the worst entry in the trilogy. Good god. And the first act of this film is so fucking boring. I could not care less about the characters, because they literally explain this in the first two films. It takes way too long to get to the fucking point. And that's a shame, because everything after it is fine. Like, the filmmaking, the writing, it just becomes much better past that first act. Even taking too long to get to it, the point they ended up at was kinda interesting, you know? This is just a disappointing end to this trilogy. Fucking next.
74.
Imagine not letting Charlie Kaufman write your movie. Absolutely insane. Chaos Walking, man. I don't even think Charlie Kaufman could salvage this, honestly. Like, the premise itself, you know, the island where fucking you can't hear women's thoughts, it's just kind of stupid. It's not really well thought out. And the biggest problem of this film is just boring, bland, generic filmmaking. You know, the actors try. Fucking Tom Holland's there. Fucking Daisy Ridley's there. They're trying. That's about it. Missed this. At least Charlie Kaufman secured the bag. Next.
73.
Resident Evil, Welcome to Raccoon City. At least the director clearly liked the source material more than Paul W.S. Anderson. But still, this is, it's kind of a bad movie. Like, you know, he tried. This director clearly tried. He poured some effort into it. The visual style is kind of interesting. I kind of like all the weird zooms and stuff he did, but oh god, the writing is just bad. The dialogue could be super fucking cringe. And it's a giant clusterfuck of a story, because how are you supposed to mash Resident Evil 1 and 2 together? 2 is the consequence of 1. Like, what are you doing? This makes no sense. A for effort, but fuck off, miss this. Next.
72.
Yeah. Jungle Cruise. It was certainly a film. Motion pictures. Pictures moving were being bombarded at my face. Oh god. I mean, Dwayne and Emily, I guess they were charming. But, you know, they were just being themselves. Just not much effort being shown there. You know, Jesse Plemons was handing it up. I loved that. Loved that guy. And the filmmaking, it was just safe. It was effective. It bland. There were some decent special effects and character designs. The guy shooting snakes out of him, that was fucking cool. And fucking, there's this repeated use of fucking an orchestral symphonic version of Nothing Else Matters by Metallica. And that was just a bizarre fucking choice. Like, there are other songs that would have fit this setting, this tone, way better. Man, this is just a bland fucking Disney film. Nothing to miss here. Next.
71.
There's a full review of this on the channel, but, Snyder Cut. It was surprisingly not terrible. The length, just a warning, the length of this film, fucking gargantuan. Fucking 4-hour fucking film. Good fucking God. But the added content, the rearranged content, helps flesh out the characters more effectively, I find. And the special effects and the visuals of the film, the cinematography, the editing, it's more natural looking. It clearly fits the tone that Snyder's universe was going for. The plot of this film is still fucking edgy as all hell, though. It's just as dumb as the fucking Whedon cut in certain respects. Props to Zach, though, for seeing his vision through. And it's beautiful that he did this for his kid. Good job, Zach. Next.
70.
Look, you thought Far Cry 6 was fucking bland. Fucking Tom Clancy's Rip Out Remorse. This, sir, is the definition of... And some of the action scenes were kind of neat. I remember one being in like a bathroom. That was kind of fun. And Michael B. Jordan, he gave an amicable performance. He was a fine enough action guy. And the plot, though, was just the most boring and trite bullshit ever. This is the most Tom Clancy movie I've ever fucking seen. Had all the fucking tropes imaginable. Fucking boring ass film. Next.
69.
Don't Look Up, new Adam McKay film. Fucking annoys me so much what Adam McKay has become. Technically, he's a fine director. He's clearly found his voice with this sort of film. And the performances really carry this film. Leonardo DiCaprio, he is fucking great in this movie. But the writing of this film is so fucking obnoxious. The themes are so fucking ham-fisted and shoved right down your throat, and the humor of this film barely fucking lands, if ever. It's super preachy, and Adam McKay needs to just stop this and make a dumb fucking comedy again. Seriously. Aside from Leo's performance, you can miss this and not feel bad at all. Next.
68.
This was the weakest of these untold documentaries that I've seen. The subject ended up being kind of boring, you know, from a psychology perspective, you know, studying how athletes, you know, think and how they react to things. Kind of interesting. Ultimately, though, this film had nothing else to say about anything, and it was just pointless. Next.
67.
Willy's Wonderland, this was a fun enough film, I think. Fucking Nick Cage, he went full cage meter, but he didn't say a fucking word throughout it, and that was fucking hilarious. But the other characters in this film were obnoxious, and the story, this whole fucking satanic cult, but with fucking Five Nights at Freddy's thing, is kind of silly. Technically, it's really inconsistent in every aspect. Sometimes it was kind of good, sometimes it was really fucking sketch. The only element that was consistently kind of neat was the score. I remember fucking synths and like rock music. But this was a fun Nick Cage shitpost. Maybe check it out if you're looking for something mindless to watch. Next.
66.
Army of the Dead. This was Snyder's better movie this year, though that's not saying much. The script of this film can be pretty fucking stupid, But it seems like Snyder kind of owns the fact that it's stupid. There was some solid performances. Batista was in this. He was very good. It's super inconsistent technically, especially in terms of cinematography and special effects. I've been pointed out about the dead pixels on the screen, and that's like, how do you miss that? But generally inoffensive most of the time. Overall, though, it's fun. Maybe watch it if you're looking for some mindless action. Next.
65.
This Rey and the Last Dragon is a perfectly fine Disney movie. The animation is great as usual. The performances were all right. Fucking Awkwafina. We'll talk about her later. But she was not too obnoxious. Sandra Oh, Daniel Day-Kim, they were super charming in this film. But the script for this film was like very middle of the road. And that's a shame because like the setting and the characters were all kind of interesting. And even when they could have gone down some very interesting routes, the writers just pussed the fuck out. Oh god, if you like Disney, maybe check it out, but you ain't missing much. Next.
64.
This was a fairly weak sequel to a decent movie. Like, the cinematography and editing was neat. Same as the last movie. The set pieces were super well done. I loved the fucking fight scene near the end where they're fighting in the dark and there's all these flashing lights. That was cool. And the audio design was really well done at times. Stephen Lang, he fucking crushes it in this role. I love this performance. But the writing could be super fucking weird. The goal of trying to humanize this fucking cretin, it's fucking bizarre. Like, he worked as a villain in the first film, but now we're trying to make him like a sympathetic anti-hero? What? Whatever. It's not as clever as the first film, but it's still pretty damn fun. Next.
63.
It played out like I expected it to. You know, the filmmaking was super bland. The only element I really liked was the score. It's kind of nice. The script was super clunky in terms of like the nuts and bolts of the writing and the structure of the story. Kind of worked, but not well, but the characters, though, carry it. They were charming enough, and the performances were fun. The little girl playing Harold Ramis' granddaughter, she was fucking great in this role. Fucking born to play that role. This film got some laughs out of me. In terms of, like, fan service nonsense, it's not as good as Spider-Man, but it's still fun. Check it out if you're a Ghostbusters fan, because it reached the low bar of being better than Ghostbusters 2016. Next.
62.
So, when people complain about fucking boring horror movies, they're probably envisioning something like this film, Lamb. Like, when the film gets going, the characters can be kind of interesting. I like the idea of a mother dealing with her daughter's death by caring for this fucking abomination. And the performances throughout the film are strong, and the themes of it are kind of thoughtful. But it takes way too fucking long to get to the fucking point. This human lamb thing looked fucking silly in terms of special effects and presentation. It only looked kind of creepy in one shot, and that's it? This is weak stuff, decent elements, but maybe you'll get more out of this. I didn't get much out of it. Next.
61.
New Candyman film? It's kind of fine. The first third or so was just rehashing the first movie. Nothing much happens. But once the twist happens, that's when it gets really fucking interesting. And the performances in this film are solid. Gaga turns out a decent performance. I really like him in this movie. And the special effects in this film were solid, especially all the gore. It looked fucking great. And the cinematography, the editing, it was all okay in general. But the score, it could have used a little more Philip Glass. Kind of boring. Philip Glass did the score better in the first film. Yeah. Overall, this film's not that amazing, but it's still a decent enough time. Next.
60.
There's a full review on the channel, but Enormous Ape versus the Irradiated Scaly Thing was what I expected it to be. The human characters in this film, though, weren't as obnoxious as, say, Godzilla King of the Monsters, though the dialogue in the film was certainly fucking hammy. And the plot of this film, it isn't smart, but it knows what it is. It's just here to have a fun time. All the big monster fights, though, fucking awesome. And the special effects were killer, and there was some really fun lighting in certain scenes. That giant fight where they're in, I think, like Tokyo or something, and it was all just neon purples and blues. It was fucking trippy and wild. Fun action. Check it out if you like fucking kaijus fighting. Yay. Next.
59.
They went to space. They did the meme. This might be the best Fast and Furious film. Oh my god. This is such a dumb movie. Oh, the characters were so over the top and fucking corny. And the plot just borders on fucking nonsense. But in terms of unironic nice things to say, the character arc between Dom and his brother, it was kinda cute. And for an action movie, this was fine enough filmmaking, visually. Good god, I love where they've taken this franchise. And if you love this dumb fucking franchise like I do, give this film a go, good god. Next.
58.
There's a full review of this on the channel, but Black Widow had some elements I enjoyed. The characters could be genuinely charming, and the story could be really dark and super interesting in its themes. But you know, it kind of became fucking dumb and loud and turned into typical Marvel shit. And the filmmaking throughout the film was unimpressive at best. Solid enough, I guess. Next.
57.
Halloween Kills. This film, at its best, is fucking hysterical. When this film didn't give a fuck, it was off the chain. The gore was up to snuff in terms of slasher films. The kills were just fucking funny. The girl shooting herself in the head was hilarious. But when it took itself seriously, that's when the film got fucking sloppy. Dialogue was super fucking corny and blunt, and it still has issues from Halloween 2018 that they just weren't going to resolve. Like, come on, why'd you have to retcon too? It would have made the serious elements work better. But the filmmaking in general was solid enough. It just wasn't as inspired as 2018. It's a fun slasher film. Maybe give it a go. Next.
56.
Screw all of you. I got what I paid for. I saw Venom fighting Carnage on the big screen. Fuck yes. The special effects in Venom 2 were pretty cool. The symbiotes looked fucking awesome. And the performances were alright. Tom Hardy, Woody Harrelson were pretty solid as Venom and Carnage. The film script kind of misunderstood Carnage a little bit, and it led to the plot being kind of fucking stupid. The humor was kind of cringe throughout as well, but I ended up getting some chuckles out of me most of the time. It's a dumb movie, I admit it, but it had the characters I liked, and it did right by them more or less. You know, like I said, I got what I paid for. Next.
55.
Fear Street Part 2, this is a solid continuation of the Fear Street saga. The filmmaking style remains the same, you know, doesn't do much new. While it retreads certain themes from the first film, the characters in this are pretty interesting. The gore is just as great as the first film, but I found Part 2 to be a little more gratuitous than Part 1, which I wasn't a fan of, surprisingly. Like, you know, what I liked about... I'll explain what I liked about Part 1 later. But overall, Fear Street Part 2, fine enough slasher. Give it a watch. Next.
54.
The Little Things, that was a pretty solid little mystery thriller. Performances from the cast, we have Denzel Washington, Rami Malek, Jared Leto, they were all really good. Jared Leto especially, you know, all the shit he gets, he's still a pretty damn good actor, you know. The characters were quite compelling. Denzel's was pretty interesting. It's a fairly typical sort of crime thriller, typical mystery. Nothing too special, but the pieces were all set up and they were paid off really nicely. Filmmaking really had its moments. The score in this film was pretty decent, and it had one or two really nicely shot sequences, you know. It's a pretty solid film. Check it out if you want. Next.
53.
Alexandra Aja, once again, makes something really cool that doesn't stick the landing at all. Oxygen, man. It's a really cool set design and computer effects in this film. I love single-person casts and character pieces like this. And this film, in a lot of respects, delivered. The main performance was really good, but the script could just get really silly near the end. And it's really muddled in terms of themes. Alexandra Aja needs to, like, do something by a guy who knows how to, like, write a cohesive story. Check this film out if you like sci-fi stuff. Next.
52.
Untold Deal with the Devil. This was a pretty interesting documentary. I was gonna be honest, I never knew about Christy Martin. And shame on me, this woman's a fucking badass. She's a fighter in every respect. The film had a predictable sort of, you know, story to it. Like, I could tell where this was going, even without knowing who Christy Martin is. But it was still compelling, nonetheless. And it presented its subjects more or less honestly. And I actually had a conversation with a boxer, like a female boxer I know from college. And she pointed out that maybe this film could have presented the more positive things Christy had done since this incident with her abusive husband, you know. Claire Affner, shout out. Cool. Cool girl. Cool lady. Cool lady. Fuck, I don't know. This is still a compelling documentary. I say check it out.
51.
The Woodstock 99 documentary, Peace, Love, Rage. This film could really grate on my nerves, especially the interviewees. They could really delve a bit too much into fucking cringe leftism talking points. And, you know, this story was really compelling, and it didn't need that to be compelling. Like, fucking Woodstock 99 was fucking nightmarish on its own. The editing and compiling of all this footage painted a really scary, wild picture. And, like, oh good God, fucking the late 90s were truly a lawless wasteland. Good God. This is a pretty fun documentary, though. I say check it out. Next.
50.
Edgar Wright's latest, man, is a bit of a disappointment. Technically, it's fucking superb. As I would expect it to be, it's fucking Edgar Wright. I love the soundtrack and cinematography in this film. The shots are just beautiful. The framing, the lighting, oh, mwah. The story started really promising with really interesting themes. And then it devolved into fucking nonsense really quickly. But mechanically, I guess the story kind of worked. It just really fell flat, like, at the end. It turned into fucking, like, Law and Order, Criminal Minds tier fucking crime drama bullshit. Overall, it's worth it for Edgar Wright's talent as a director. But, you know, not his best effort. Next. Well, that's all the not that good movies out of the way. Let's talk about the good ones now.